go back to Revelation chapter 13. And so last week we read up to verse 10. Today we're going to look at verse 11 through 18. And I'm really going to concentrate, so I did the last 2 weeks, I really concentrated on two verses in chapter 12, and I really concentrated heavily on two spots in this passage, and it's really verse 12 and then verse 17 that I'm going to land on today. But let me read the whole passage to you. Second beast is coming, this is the Antichrist. So, then I saw another beast rising out of the earth, and it had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast in its presence, and makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast. Okay, we know who the first beast is, right? Satan. We talked about that. I know we're doing a lot deeper work on Wednesday night, but so it performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to the earth in front of people. And by the signs, it is allowed to work in the presence of the beast. It deceives those who dwell on earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that was wounded by the sword and yet lived. And it was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. And it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark, that is, the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. Is number 666. I want to talk a little bit about the real subtle presence of the Antichrist. Sometimes not so subtle, but you know, Billy Graham once said this about these passages. He said, and looking at this, he said, imagine a situation in which a Christian in the ancient world is offered freedom, okay, if he or she will simply engage in the ritual of offering incense to Caesar. That's kind of what's going on here in the first century. We talked about a little bit of this when we looked at the seven churches, and you know, just offer some food, just offer some incense. Just all you have to do is make an offering to Caesar as God, and then you can do whatever else you want to do, okay? Otherwise, we're going to throw you in the arena, and the lions are going to eat you. And so, you know, somebody might say, well, who would be so stubborn as to choose suffering instead of this simple act, right? But the act of offering the incense, the act of offering the food, whatever it might be, constituted a much greater disobedience than just the simple act might apply. And Jesus commands his true followers to refuse to see this as unacceptable, any offering to another god. I once was in a conversation, I was much younger, but it was a group of believers, and I don't remember the exact situation, but there had been some Christians taken hostage, and they were murdered, and it was in a place where the nation was hostile to Christianity. They were murdered because they were Christians. And in the conversation, it came up I remember people saying, well, wouldn't it just be smarter just to tell them you weren't a Christian and get out of there, get back to the United States, and then say, oh, but I am a Christian. And this turned into a real argument. Well, doesn't God value life? You know, somebody might say, well, then save your life and denounce your Christianity and then renounce your Christianity, right? Well, some people might argue that, but I'm telling you, what these people were doing, they were just being told you needed to offer incense to Caesar, and we won't kill you. That's a lot simpler than, you know, the question we were arguing about. John's living in the time of Domitian, the great, horrible, however you want to say it, the emperor of John's time when he's writing this, and Domitian didn't think much of Christians, and we don't have an emperor like Domitian here in the United States. We don't have someone telling us, do this, and whatever else you do, it's okay, but do this, worship me, call me God, whatever else you do, I won't care. We don't have that, but we really don't need a Domitian in our life to be confronted with this kind of conflict in our life. I've used Hitler in some of these passages over the last few weeks to kind of demonstrate. None of us are old enough to really remember a time when there were people who were thinking that Hitler was the Antichrist, and it really looked like it. It really appeared as though that could be. But there were Christians that lived in the time of Hitler, that lived in Germany at the time when they could see the significance, the comparison here of a earthly Antichrist and really Germany's totalitarian state and the propaganda that it pushed really fit in with some of the things that people were looking for at the end of time. And you think about it, why not? Why not? You know, Satan doesn't know when Jesus is coming back, right? Saint Mark, only God the Father knows the time. And so, really, you think about it, Satan really needs an Antichrist in waiting just about any time, right? Because you think about this, when this all begins to come about, Satan's going to need an Antichrist, right? Okay? And so he really needs one in waiting. In a bigger sense, though, the temptation mirrors all the temptations to really incorporate a world that is against God. Really, really, all of these temptations just really mirror the culture of a world that we live in that is against God. And so, the question that comes of this passage that John wrote was, would the early Christians adopt their society's values, cultural values? And we saw, as we studied some of the churches in Revelation, yeah, they did. They did. Or would they come out, literally, as Revelation chapter 18 is going to show, would they come out of the world? Okay, so the question is, will Christians adopt the culture they live in, the morals, the values of their society, or will they come out of it? Okay? It's a question that really challenges churches and followers today. That's kind of the question of the day. You know, by the time Revelation was written, 60 or so years after Jesus, the world had already seen a lot of these kind of rulers, a lot of people had offered them up as an example of what the Antichrist would look like. We look in the Old Testament, you see the kings of Babylon, right? They were king and they thought they were God. Okay? king of Tyre. We see in Ezekiel, same thing, thought he was God. Pharaoh thought he was God. In Daniel, probably Epiphanes the third, it was probably, but he thought he was God. In fact, you know, eventually Epiphanes was worshipped on the altar in the temple, led to the Maccabean revolt. So we have plenty of pagan rulers. Saddam Hussein thought himself to be Nebuchadnezzar reincarnated, had him portraits made of himself as Nebuchadnezzar. Saddam Hussein thought he was going to rule the world. Okay? There's a guy over in North Korea right now thinks he's God, and his people worship him as God. Okay? So we have a lot of examples of these Antichrist type figures. But I think what really should frighten us most, and that's a scary thing, right? It's a scary thing that we got a guy over in North Korea with a bunch of nuclear bombs thinking he's God and he controls the world, okay? I think he really thinks it. I think he really does. His dad did and his grandpa did, and I think he does, okay? You talk about raising a child up in a culture where they will, that child was raised in the wrong kind of culture. Okay, was raised in a culture that told him every day of his life, you are God. One day you will rule the world. And now he believes it, right? Okay, so you see kind of the opposite of what I was talking about in the baby dedication. But what should really frighten us even more is that the same spirit of this, you know, self-deifying, wanting to be God, spirit remains in every single human heart that seeks to make oneself the center of life. Okay? And a lot of the way we do that is kind of to push down the understanding of our own mortality. Okay? Every single one of us is mortal. Flesh and blood. Okay? The only way we have another breath is by the grace of God, okay? And we need to be thankful for that next breath, that next moment, that next month, week, month, year. And so that's really what scares me, or what, when I read a passage like that where I begin to fear, you know, this consumer culture we live in, consume, consume, you deserve it, you should have it, everything you want. It kind of has democratized. Isn't that funny that you put consumerism and democracy kind of in the same sentence? But that's kind of America. We're us consumers. We've kind of democratized our self-idolatry. Well, you say, what are you talking about? You say, well, it's this thought that I'm the greatest. You know why? Because I think I'm the greatest. And my culture, my society tells me that's a good way to think. Ooh, that's a good way to think. You're the greatest because you think you're the greatest. Doesn't matter what anybody else thinks about you. You're the greatest. You're your own God. And you know what? Gods really deserve everything they want. Everything is theirs. Everything is here for them. If that were true, if that were actually true, what a sweet way to live, really. If that were the truth. There's just one little problem with thinking you're God and everybody else thinking they're God. Doesn't work out, does it? You think you're God and your neighbor thinks they're God, and the next are, well, who's going to be God? It's just not going to work out. But our society wants us to live and to think that way. Okay? And so that's what really scares me. Yeah, it scares me that the guy over in North Korea thinks he's God. But what really scares me is that the people I live and work and am friends with, they're beginning to act like they're God. They're beginning to think they're God. They're beginning to think this, all that's here is here for me and for me to consume, and it's all about me and what I believe and what I want to do. And so kind of pushing down that mortality. We kind of push down our morality too. You know, in verse 12, it says, it exercises all the authority of the first beast in its presence, so the Antichrist, in the presence of Satan, and makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, Satan, whose mortal wound was healed. Just a kind of trying to identify Satan as like the lamb. But we know that's not true, right? Because the real lamb died in weakness and was raised by God's power, right? The real lamb, Jesus, he died on the cross and was raised in God's power. So the fake lamb here promotes one who pretends to have recovered in no less a significant way. In verse 12. See, the devil's counterfeits and Satan's counterfeits, however you think of him, whatever you call him, his counterfeits, they get their legitimacy, okay? Their ability to be worshipped, their ability to be admired from doing what? Imitating God, okay? And so, you know, those who do not embrace the very hard, the very difficult message of the cross and its suffering are really susceptible to falling to these counterfeits. So hear that. Those who do not embrace the very difficult, the very hard message of the cross and its suffering are very susceptible to these counterfeits. And, you know, this happened in 1930s in Germany in a big way. In a big way. Hitler, when he first got started, pretended to be a friend of the church. Okay? Came to the church, and I've discussed some of the pretenses that he came under. But he pretended to be friendly to church leaders. And in 1930s Germany, I'm not going to get where I want to go today, but I think this is important for us to see, because history repeats itself. If you don't study history, you're making a big mistake. So we talk about where the gospel is gone, how it's eroded, right? So my whole point here, the main point I'm getting to, if you give up, if as a faith we give up the hard message of the cross, okay, the difficult message of the cross and suffering, then we become susceptible. So in 1930s Germany, it was very different than 1930s United States of America. The theology, the doctrine of Germany had already drifted way off course, okay? What we call liberal theology. So things like the deity, the deity of Christ, and all kinds of things. What we believed about the Word of God, all of these things begin to drift. So church leaders, pastors in Germany, they were in a tough spot. And here this charismatic leader, who everyone loves, portrays himself as a friend of the church. Okay? He comes to them as a friend of the church. And I tell you what, none of them were more happy than the leaders of the Protestant church in Germany. Yes! Our leader is he must be a man of God. Look, he wants to be a friend of the church. And the leaders of the Protestant church were in trouble in Germany in this time. Y'all know where Luther was German. The Reformation began here in Germany, right? The tenets we, you know, our foundation came out of Germany and it began to slip. It began to fall to liberalism. And, And so these church leaders were like, yes, yes. Then you had people like Bonhoeffer say, wait a minute. And Bonhoeffer would preach things like the message of false messiahs. Hitler didn't like that. The Nazis didn't like this message. Bonhoeffer lectures on the person of Jesus very daringly included the preaching of what it would look like if false messiahs came. This was a direct challenge to Hitler, who contrasted with himself, Hitler himself contrasted himself with the humiliated and crucified Messiah. And so these challenges really, they drew the anger of the Nazis. And so Christianity has become increasingly more and more acceptable in recent years in America. Why? Why is Christianity more acceptable to non-believers in America than it ever has been? Why do you think that is? Why are non-Christians no longer bothered by Christians the way they used to be? I think we're getting close to using the word in a lot of ways in parts of our country irrelevant. It's not even acceptable. It's the same thing that's happened and the same thing that's warned about. When those who do not embrace the hard message of the cross and its suffering, we then become very susceptible to counterfeits. In this passage, there's a lot of persecution, right? And I've talked about that in previous weeks. I don't want to jump right over there. There's a lot of persecution. So I'm going to move to verse 17 because I think this is very important. So you take an age or a generation, a group of Christians who have lost the teaching of the cross, this difficult teaching of the cross. They've removed the message, the teaching of the cross, become susceptible to counterfeits. And then look at verse 17. So that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark. That is the same of the beast or the number of its name. What's going on here? There's this economic temptation here. Okay? This is so relevant. So these people couldn't do what? They couldn't buy or sell unless they had the mark. Okay? Unless they were seen as belonging to this Antichrist, okay? They couldn't buy or sell. What if all of a sudden you couldn't buy or sell? Couldn't buy or sell anything. It's going to be a problem, right? You're not going to be able to earn a living. You're not going to be able to eat. So you say, is this relevant in 2017 to us today? Yes, it is. It's you know, Christians in Thyatira, remember they said, hey, wait a minute, we just really want to keep our jobs. We're not really worshiping any kind of idols or anything. We just want to keep our jobs. We think it's real important, you know, to keep going to the temple. And so Thyatira really could identify with this. Later Christians have always faced this temptation to compromise. Think about this. I think insightful Christians today might likewise recognize the links that appear in many professions today. Think about this. What if you were real talented? Comedian, actor, something like that. A Christian one. You're a really talented... Does that even go together? I mean, I don't know. I mean, you're a very talented musician, actor, actress, whatever it may be. Or maybe you're a Christian who wants to get into politics. You really think you can make a difference in the political atmosphere in our nation. Okay? Or maybe you're a Christian and you're a really good football player or basketball player or baseball player, okay? And you've got a career in sports. Now think about the temptation to compromise your morals and your beliefs in order to be successful in any of those careers. Think of what it must be like. I can tell you one bright and shiny example is Tim Tebow. I read an article just last week that a Sports Illustrated writer wrote, and I love the article because he was finally saying, get off his back. He's a tremendous athlete, and yes, you may not like it that he believes in Jesus, but get off his back about it. But Tim Tebow's been very limited in his opportunities because his belief in Jesus Christ and his standing up for his belief. So think about it. Think about it. You want to be an actor, you want to be an actress, but you want to stand up for your belief in Jesus. What are they going to say to you? You want to be a politician? Wow, I can't even imagine that. Could you imagine being an evangelical Christian politician? I'm not talking about claiming you're one. I'm not talking about going to universities and saying you're one. I'm talking about really walking the walk, picking up your cross daily. What would that look like? I think we all know. So there's a compromise that has to be made to be successful, right? And I bring up these things because you say, well, I'm not any of those things, but I'm telling you, it's not any different for those that you are carpenters or plumbers or whatever you do. It's not any different. There is a pressure every day for you in your conversations, in your actions, in all that you do to compromise, to be successful in whatever you want to do economically. And this is what was going on in Asia Minor. And if you wouldn't worship Caesar, you were not allowed to buy or sell. Okay? Think about, is this different from any of us who tell people what they want to hear about themselves? Who tell people what they want to hear about Jesus? What they want to hear? I mean, I know pastors, God bless them, I know pastors personally who are very afraid of alienating people in their church because of what they give. It's a sad day when I have lunch and talk with a pastor and their biggest fear is upsetting someone in their church because it might damage what they give to the church financially. I read a story, this was just 2 weeks ago. I read a story about a pastor who was asked by a member who led a person to Jesus, you know, away from the church, who had explained to a member, the member knew how to explain what it meant to become a Christian, and he had done that with the person. That person had come to the church and become a member of the church. Well, the person that he led to Christ wanted to know why the pastor never really explained what it really meant to be a follower of Jesus in the church. He never heard what he heard from the guy who shared Jesus with him in the church. He never heard what it meant to be a follower of Jesus in the church, and he wanted to know why. And the pastor said they had to be very careful what he preached because of the deacons. This is a true story. I thought, wow. You know, to be sure we want to communicate truth in the most strategic way, and I want to be sensitive to people, no doubt about it, but what happens when we're more concerned about what people think than whether we're helping people, right? What I'm saying saying that we engage in these same kind of compromises. All of us, these same compromises. We only think people like Tim Tebow have to go through. We go through the same thing. In our culture, we often confront the temptation to tell people what they want to hear rather than what we genuinely hear God saying that we need to tell them. Has that ever happened to you? I mean, think about it. You don't have to raise your hand. But have you ever been talking to someone and you've truly sensed, I truly believe God wants me to share Jesus with this person. And then you had another conscious thought that was, but I'm going to be very embarrassed in the situation I'm in if I start talking about Jesus. This is exactly what I'm talking about, David. If that's ever happened to you, you've been in this pressure to compromise. You know, we see this compromise all the time. You know, I wasn't there, so I don't know. And I can't say I wouldn't have done it. So I'm not pretending that I'm better than anyone else. But I look at the 1960s in Baptist life across the Deep South, and it's embarrassing the way that pastors did not stand up in the civil rights movement and say, this is wrong. They did it. And again, I'm not saying I would have been any better. I don't know. I wasn't there. I don't know the pressures. This is pressure to compromise. Okay? You know, I often wonder if they had, how many pastors would have not been a pastor the next week? Probably most of them. But I'm telling you what, there are as many pastors today, I feel it. If you don't see this, you need to see it. But there's many pastors today that feel the same type of pressure to compromise. The closest two Baptist churches to us, the pastors, I guarantee you, are feeling this compromise. One comes from the far left, one comes from the far right. Because one pastor stands in the pulpit and says that we need to carpet bomb ISIS. And from here, where do you think his pressure is coming from? He talks about building a wall between the United States and Mexico. Where do you think his pressure is coming from? From the people in his church? You think he would bother to mention it in the pulpit if it wasn't coming from people in his church? Why talk about those kind of political things in the pulpit if you're not getting pressured from people? So where's his pressure coming from? The far right, right? So he feels the need to talk about ISIS and immigration. And then another church on the other side stands at the pulpit and says, and it messes with me every time I drive home. I probably should drive home a different way. But if you go home down Abrams, there's a new sign that says, I never thought I would go back to the Baptist church till I went to Wilshire. Makes me mad. Because I know what it means. It means if you're gay, you can go to church here. Where's his pressure coming from? He's been on the news. He's been on the radio. He's talking about how he was wrong all those years about what the Bible said about homosexuality. He's completely wrong about it. That doesn't happen, people. You can't preach God's word for 50 years and all of a sudden wake up one day and you have been completely wrong about it. God doesn't speak to ministers in that way. But my point is not to draw your attention to either two of those places. It's to show you that pastors today are under no less pressure to compromise than white pastors were in segregated South in the 60s, to stand on one side or the other. Okay? And you say, well, I just thought of this. I said, well, I don't know that I would have done any different in the 60s. I don't know what I would have done. I don't know. But I kind of do, because I know where I stand today. I know where I stand today. And both of these things are wrong. Both of these things are wrong. We are not to be ministers of God's word and stand in the pulpit and talk about things that, like I mentioned, that are political. They don't belong here. What belongs here is the message of the cross and of Jesus Christ. Okay? What we need to be talking about, so that people won't compromise their values and their lives, is what it means to be a Christian. And that means adopting the difficulty, the suffering of the message of the cross. okay, let me go back to my sermon. And so, if status, okay, and I talk about status, let me just tell you, I wouldn't want to be pastors of either one of those churches. I really wouldn't, because I don't want to deal with either one of those groups of people that they have to deal with. I don't want it. I love you guys. But thank goodness we don't talk about some of those things, or we know where we stand on them, right? And then this materialism, the other parts of it. So it's status and materialism. If it's so easy to entice us with those things, materialism and status, isn't that what we're told? You should be God. If we can't handle this, how are we ever going to stand persecution? You know? If we fall to the lure of status, if we fall to the lure of materialism, how are we ever going to stand up when we have to face persecution? I know some of you are probably thinking, I just hope I die before then. I just hope I die before then. But this could be 5 years from now. Now, how are we going to stand to this kind of persecution? I don't know when it's going to be, but that's the question. And you know, and I think indeed, because, you know, some of these things, when you just get them down to the nitty-gritty of the way that they affect Greg in Dallas, Texas, you know, every time we buy something because our neighbors have it or someone else has it, think about that. Every time we purchase something because we see an advertisement and we're told, you have to have this, we compromise with the world's system, okay? I'm trying to take what's going on 2,000 years ago and really give you a picture of what it looks like. I mean, again, and these are things that we could talk about more in depth. And, you know, what does the word frivolous mean? Well, it might mean something different to me than a guy living in Highland Park. Being frivolous to me, you know, to some people might be, well, do I supersize it or not? Because, I mean, it's another $1.50, I don't know. When another guy says, well, I've never eaten at a place where they allow supersizing, I would not stoop to supersize, you know. So what is frivolous? But I say this, can we be frivolous when we know that every day, I've used this statistic, it's been a couple years, every day, Sunday, today, tens of thousands of people will die from starvation. So today, in the world, tens of thousands of people will go hungry and die from it. Okay? Today. We know, because we have Christian organizations that says a few pennies. It may cost you $3 to get fries, a Coke, and a burger on the value meal at McDonald's, but for a few pennies, we can feed a child. Give it another day. A few pennies. and so that's one way I bring it up. But then I want you to think of it this way too. I see people, so that there's one way it gets us, okay? But another way it gets us, I see people who work and work and work and work 60, 70, 80 hours a week, okay? And you say, for what? For my family. I do it for my family. And then people, I've been there. I've been on the other side of this. I know what it's like to work 80 or 90 hours a week to accomplish something that you think is great or you think is what you need to be doing. But let me tell you, I don't think you need to work 60, 70, 80, 90 hours a week to provide for your family. I think what may be needed in our families a little more is for some of the men and women to take 10 or 15 of those hours that they're given to the company and give it to their children. And it would be better served. Okay? You see how the beast gets us? I feel for this next generation. I kind of thought you guys, and I'm going over again. It's 3 weeks in a row. I'm sorry, we ain't got babies in here. You know, I used to think you millennials had it made. They got the college paid for, whether they got $1 million in student debt or mom paid for it. Either way, they got it paid for, right? And a lot of them still living at home. But now they're getting into the workforce. And they're going to these places. Some of you may already know about this. Sully and Maylin working in this kind of environment. So they're not here this week. You seen these workplaces that you go into and it looks like the lobby at an airport? You got chairs and video screens and Wi-Fi and all kinds of things going on. If you want to bring your kids, there's a place they can play over here. And if you need to have a meeting, everybody just comes together. You just pull your chairs together and you have a meeting. Oh, we don't have a time clock. We don't do any of those kind of things around here because we're not that kind of company. But I'm meeting these young people that work in these places. They go work 10 or 12 hours in this environment. Oh, I forgot to mention the free coffee and all that stuff. They work 10 or 12 hours in this environment. Then they get home and they jump right back on their computers and start working. And they work till it's time to go to bed and they start working on tomorrow. And they always feel behind, and they put them on teams. And then they have another team, and those teams are competing with each other, okay, to be the best team at doing whatever they do. These same people, they leave church on Sunday, if they go, and they can't wait to get home to jump back on the computer to get ready for Monday morning. They work 80, 90, 100 hours a week, but you know what? They don't have any time clock. We don't have a time clock. We don't want you to feel pressured. It's brilliant. It's brilliant, and it's just another example of what I'm talking about. They got them. They've got this next generation. They got them. So let me kind of bring this around. So in 13 and 16 through 18, it talks about this mark of the beast. And this is where sometimes, you know, my end of times thinking is not the same as a lot of people, but nobody really has the same end of times thinking. But I want to press this, and I pressed it a couple weeks ago. And I think however you feel this mark is or what this mark is going to look like, you can see what I'm talking about. So all the previous marks that we've seen in Revelation have been symbolic. Okay, they haven't been physical. Okay? In chapter 3, chapter 7, chapter 14, and then again in 17, 19, and 22, the marks are symbolic. They're not a physical mark. Okay? And so don't think of this as just trying to satisfy your end of time curiosity. Because I've sat in lectures for hours when people explain the 666. I've sat through hours even where they tried to use the grocery scan bar to try to convince me the grocery scan bar was it, and we were buying groceries with scan bars and buying into, okay, not even thinking that. Get away from your end time curiosity. I think what John's doing here is warning each and every one of us about compromise. Okay? About compromise. This mark technically functions just like a slave brand. So in John's time, if you were a slave, you had a brand on you. Actually, through all time, if you were a slave, people put some type of mark on you. So this mark, think of it as like a slave brand that one receives. So if you don't worship the beast, you get a brand, okay? But I completely think this, like all the other marks, is symbolic. I think like the seal back in chapter 7 of those who were God's followers. I don't think they had a mark on them. I think everybody knew who they were because they were following Jesus, okay? So if back in chapter 7, if the mark, if the seal is that one was known because they were truly following Jesus, I think the same thing for the people who follow the beast. I don't think the world's going to have, I don't think they're going to have to put 666 on your head or your forehead to know whether you follow the beast or whether you follow Jesus, is what I'm trying to say. Okay? So you think, wow, in the end of times, it's going to be really clear if you follow Jesus or not. Everybody's going to know in the end of times if you're a true follower of Jesus or if you're a follower of the beast. Let me tell you, people, they don't have any trouble telling now. People don't have any trouble telling now whether you follow Jesus or you follow the beast. It's just the same as what we talked about last week and the week before, the fear of verse 7 and 8 in chapter 12. The fear that I have that people will be lured into this and it is compromised. They're, you know, servants of God are going to be known in the end of times. And we know what's going to happen to them. Okay? I don't think the distinction's any less today. I think those who take the mark of the beast, I think this is symbolic here, those who compromise themselves, those who give in to the lure of status, to materialism, people know it. And it's not for me to stand in the pulpit right now and really talk about in detail this, but I think it's something we all should be aware of and be talking about. I think it's something that's very important. Again, hard passage, hard for someone to get up and try and work through and apply to our lives today. And like I started with last week, why do we pastors do it? Why do we do what we do? Because it would be so much easier for me to get up here and have you come in here on Sunday morning and me just give you a bunch of stuff that makes you feel good. You know? People say that to me sometimes. I'm here, I just want you to make me feel better so I can go out and tackle the world. And really, in a lot of ways, even when we get into messages like this, this is what it's supposed to do. It is supposed to make you feel better. You say, how? How is this supposed to make me feel better? Well, I think it comes down to, like it's come down in Revelation all along, is we need to decide. We need to make a decision. Okay? Greg and everyone else in here. You could say Ridgecrest, but it's much more personal than that, right? What does our sign say? I'm just going to make a point. Does anybody know what our sign says out front? That's close. You know why no one knows? Because I put that on that sign. And that's my passion. And I wanted that on that sign. And I've yet, after 4.5 years, to be able to make that your passion. Right? As much as... This isn't... I'm not beating up anybody. I'm just saying. When this neighborhood drives by that sign and they read it, I think a lot of them kind of chuckle. Kind of laugh. And I think this is what this passage is pointing to. We need to decide between God and the world. Because we could all go buy t-shirts that say, I'm of another world, right? They sell those. I see people wear them all the time. Not of this world. I'm of another world. We could get them custom made and put Ridgecrest on there too. So everybody knows that not only are we not of this world, but we go to Ridgecrest. I tell you what, you put that t-shirt on, you better start walking and following Jesus in a way that demonstrates it, right? Or what are people going to do? They're going to laugh. Okay, I think I'm trying to drive home this point of what John's doing here. It's not going to matter, you know, whether you have 666 on your forehead or not. People are already going to know. They're already going to know whether you love Jesus or not. And today, people already know whether we love Jesus. We can put it on the sign that we love God and we love people and we're making disciples. But if the people in our neighborhood don't feel like they're being loved, it's just a joke to them. Okay? It's just words on a sign. And so in the end of times, which we're in, claiming to be a follower of Jesus, right? Claiming to be saved are just words if people don't see it. If we don't live it out. So you say, Greg, I'm still waiting. I'm still waiting for why this is good. I'm still waiting for the encouragement at the end of this message. So here it is. The future doesn't belong to Babylon in this passage. The future doesn't belong to this world. The future belongs to God and those who follow Him. If we're really followers of Jesus, the future belongs to us. That's the encouragement in a passage like that. That's the encouragement I get out of the book of Revelation. The future doesn't belong to the beast. The future doesn't belong to Antichrist. The future belongs to my God. My Lord. Right? One amen. Maybe too hard.
Amen.
Father, thank you so much for this time and this place and this word. And Father, forgive me for any ways in which I digressed and failed to help people to understand it. But Father, I do feel passionately about this passage. And I do feel so passionate about the time we live in and have such a fear for our children. The same day we dedicate Josiah to the Lord, I honestly know that he's going to grow up in a world. He's going to become an adult in a world where he'll look around. And if he's in a room of 10 people, 9 of them won't be a Christian. And so, Father, I pray for him. And I pray for strength. And I pray for endurance. And I pray for the Word of God to grow in him. And understanding that we can't even imagine. I thank you for everyone here today. Pray for those who are traveling. Father, just pray anything that I said today that is of you, let it sink deeply into our hearts and mind. Anything that was not, may be forgotten as we leave this room. But Father, let the things that are of you weigh heavy on our hearts and minds, causing us a desire to follow Jesus, to unashamedly share the message of Jesus and the cross and of suffering, of pain, with no embarrassment. Father, it's only through your Holy Spirit that we're even able to share Jesus. So Father, fill us with your Spirit, empower us, embolden us, Father. We don't need t-shirts, we don't need stickers.